Hey everybody, Chuck and Stacey here with VO Buzz Weekly.
We are back with Heather Dame, formerly Heather Vergo of Atlas Talent Los Angeles. Did you watch part one? You need to. And did you subscribe? You need to.
Let's get buzzed.
Turn it up.
Get ready.
You're tuned in to VO Buzz Weekly. And now, prepare to get seriously buzzed with your hosts, Chuck Duran and Stacey J. Aswan.
So when somebody sends you a demo, and obviously, you know, there's lots of great demos out there and you hear lots of them.
Yes.
But what are some things that come to mind that you hear that will automatically be like, no, I can't not use that tool. I would never use that tool. This is not acceptable.
Oh, okay. Yes. Okay. there is a good answer to that.
Okay.
One is getting unprofessional demos, like demos that they made themselves. Oftentimes, and although there are people across the country who are engineers are good at it, and they do. So the caveat of there are people who can do it. But oftentimes it's like, you know, they just cobbled together random stuff that they did or voices they did. And honestly, it almost never showcases someone in a professional way.
Right.
It's very rare that you can find someone, unless they've got boatloads of work that they can pull from and make the demo out of work that they've done, finding that if they don't make a professional demo, that it's just not going to sit well. It's going to sound not professional.
Right.
And so it's not a tool we can use if it doesn't sound professional. I do actually typically tell people I don't want them to just pull from old work they've done, because demos are marketing tools.
Yeah.
So you want to really live into what you want to do, not what I have done. What you have done is not necessarily what you want to do in the future. And it is a sales tool.
Yeah.
So it is meant to live into what you want to do. So your demo should actually, in my opinion, a lot of these guys, even the guys who make a lot of money in promos a year, their demos aren't necessarily spots they've all done. Maybe it's one or two spots they've done, but a lot of them are stuff they want to do.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And so, you know, you think those guys don't need a demo that's made up.
Yeah.
But they do it anyways, because they're really marketing towards the next job, not the ones they've already
had. I'm glad I asked that question, because you really cleared that up very, very nicely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool.
That's a great point.
I dig it.
What, she's full of points.
Heather is so smart. No wonder you're at Atlas.
So let's say someone gets a meeting.
Okay.
Okay.
Bum, bum.
What can they expect? And what are some key things that they should have prepared for a meeting?
Good question.
They need to be ready to talk about themselves. They need to be ready to talk about if they have done jobs, what jobs they've done, what their experience in voiceover is, you know, where they fit, what kind of coaching they've done. A lot of times actors will come in and they'll have done a lot of work, but they will not remember for who and what it was.
Yeah, like the ad agency, the casting director.
Yeah, and I recommend highly having a spreadsheet. You know, you have to be a business person. Those are your contacts. The agent is actually often in contact with a different person than who the actor speaks with when they walk in the room.
Right.
So, you know, those are your contacts. You should be taking care of them. You should know who they are. You should have a database for them. You should, you know, you should be networking with those people. So when you walk in the room, you want to have that information. You want to be able to speak about your business. Mm-hmm. You know, you're a small business. You're your own little kiosk as an actor.
Right.
You need to speak smartly about your business. You know, you're in some senses like you're on Shark Tank. You know, you need to, if you didn't know anything about your business.
Yes.
I love it.
Yes.
So,
I love that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, I think that, and then other than that, there's no right answer.
Exactly.
Yeah.
No, but that's good. You come in like you own your business, be prepared.
Yeah. Having that confidence.
Yeah.
For sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Once someone is on your roster, what are, as the agent team, what are your expectations of those talent? What do they need to do on their behalf?
I mean, I think as a bare minimum, you need to be turning in your auditions on time and following directions and, you know, and getting places on time and being, you know, being really smart and good at your job, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's first and foremost. I think at the end of the day, you know, we all expect that of everybody we work with.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes actors don't always view themselves as business people, but they are. They're running their own small business.
Yep.
And so we expect that of them. We work our butts off, and we expect them to, too. You know, people do really well with us who work their butts off.
Yeah.
I mean,
absolutely.
because we get in there, we pitch business, we, you know, we really, you know, we're out there pitching and developing relationships and looking for new opportunities. And that's how we operate as an agency. And so we expect talent to do the same. There's that whole adage of the 90-10, you know?
Right, mm-hmm. right.
You make 90% of the money, do 90% of the work. And there's a part of that that's, you know, silly, but a part of it that's very true.
Completely, mm-hmm. yeah.
It's very true. They're your relationships as an actor. Yeah. As an agent, you know, as an agency, we represent multiple actors. And so we have to look at all of the interests of all of the actors combined. You know, that's just part of, you know, being an agency.
Right.
Whereas you get to have only your interest. And so there's a way that you can develop your business and serve your business in a way that we simply just aren't capable of.
Right.
You know,
right.
when you show up and there were some different networking events I went to at some point, you know, in animation, and I would meet the creative people, and they just, you know, they were just did not know what to do with me, you know, because they're not the people who cast, you know, they're different than the casting people.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
And they'd, like, they would just look at me like I was a lawyer, you know, a boring lawyer. They're just like, I don't know what to do with you. But once they heard who we represented, they're like, oh my gosh, God, I love the talent.
Yeah.
You know, so the talent have this ability to connect with people in a way that
right.
we just don't have access to. We connect in a different way.
Yeah.
So they've got to go do that.
Yeah, absolutely. You know what? You clear things up in such a really cool way. You know what
She's
I mean?
Because you've like heard a laser.
I know, but you've heard some of this stuff a million
so
times.
Good.
But
yeah.
you've never heard that little twist. You know, and you're right. Because somebody might look at you and go like, but then all of a sudden the talent has this completely different connection.
Yeah, because if they're a writer or an animator, that talent brings their piece
to life.
Right.
But me, what do I do for them? They're
you
negotiate.
Just set the talent to them. Yeah.
That's nice.
But not to them. Usually it's to a casting director.
Exactly.
In that world in animation, you're often, you know, even within where they have in-house casting, it's a separate, you know, they're separate people.
Yeah.
We're a couple steps away from, you know, the animators or the writers, you know?
Yeah. Well, and so it's a good reminder, and you touched on this earlier, that we're all on the same team.
Yeah.
The talent and the agent are on the same team. And that we're gatekeepers to different things.
Yes.
But ultimately, we have the same
mission. Well, and the idea should be that you're working it on your end, and we're working it on our end, and then we're communicating, and so then we're actually teaming together to have both sides
Making
work.
Making progress,
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Love it.
Here's a question for you, and you may not have an answer.
Okay.
Might be like one of those, I have many answers.
It's a riddle.
But because this is a problem that I hear from a lot of talent abroad. And that's that, man, I'm auditioning like crazy, you know.
Abroad?
Yeah, just talent
across
the board.
Maybe you meant a different country.
No.
Across the board.
Across the board.
Yeah.
And they're auditioning like crazy. You know, their agency is just throwing, you know, lots of auditions. They are auditioning on a regular basis. They feel they're doing a great job. Their studio sounds good. Their chops are up, man. They're working on but they're not booking. You know, so from their perspective, they're like, am I doing something wrong? From your perspective, you might have a different outlook on that. What is your outlook on that?
My outlook is that it depends on the actor, and you need to have a conversation with your agents about, you know, because it's every actor, the answer to that is not the same.
Exactly.
It really isn't. And we tend to have a little bit more of a bird's eye point of view because we see multiple actors and their careers. And you know, we have a little bit more of a bird's eye point of view that, you know, we can at least have a conversation with you about it. I am of the belief, and, you know, I think in general, our philosophy is there's always something you can be doing. In reality, sometimes the answer is there's a lot of auditions. There is. And there's a lot more competition now with technology.
Oh, yeah.
And so sometimes it is just, you know, a lot of competition. And that's what's happening. And it's very hard to book in a world where it used to be 50 people auditioning. And now somehow they've got 500 people auditioning, you know, and there are people all over the country auditioning against, you know.
Yeah.
There's positives and negatives to that. So sometimes that's the answer. But that's not always the answer. You know, sometimes it is that, you know, you could be doing more to really have your reads pop or, you know, really move to the next level or connect to the copy or, you know, you could be, there's just sometimes there's an answer yes and then sometimes not.
Exactly.
You know, and there's just no one size fits all. And that's why you need to have a partnership and relationship with your agent.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because you need to actually be able to have a conversation with them where they don't just go, yeah, you're fine.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you ever send an audition back to somebody and say,
yes.
I like what you did,
yes.
but I want to hear more of this.
Do we call
do
them?
It again.
Oh, I do that all the time.
All the time.
I do that all the time. I actually probably do that more than the negative feedback.
Right.
But we give feedback all the time.
Good.
To our talent. The agents listen to every single thing that comes into our office.
So you actually listen back to every single thing that comes in?
Yes.
Wow.
Well, but also,
that's
too,
a lot.
Yes. I mean, but we don't read people in the booth, really. It's very rare that we read people in the booth. They come in by appointment.
Okay.
So it's a different way and philosophy of operating.
Yeah.
But I didn't know agents didn't listen to all their stuff, actually, until recently.
Yeah.
Until I found that out, and I was like, oh, they don't?
They don't?
We listen to everything.
Yeah.
You know, so
somebody does.
We have a context. Yeah, somebody. But, you know, for us, the viewpoint is if we're selling you, we have to know how to sell you. How can we know how to sell you when someone calls us and they want to trust what we're telling them of, you know, who can cluck like a chicken and sound like an old British maid and I need them to come in at 9 o'clock tomorrow? You know, we have to give an answer that's honest. If we don't, that person goes in and they can't do one or the other or can't do either. You know, that casting director is not going to call again and ask that.
Yes.
You know, so there's that kind of factor to it.
What do you think are some misconceptions that talent have about agents, the role of an agent?
I think that they assume we can book them on the job oftentimes. Mm. You know, and we just don't have that power.
Right.
I mean, 9 times out of 10, particularly in this market, we really just don't have that power. Again, the best we can do is our job is to go out and get those opportunities and then try to make them as exclusive as possible.
Right.
And sometimes we get them completely exclusive to the agency,
mm-hmm.
you know, and we do that as often as we can. That's our jobs.
Yeah.
But we can't book you on the job. You know, because we don't work at those companies.
Yeah.
We are a mediator. You know, we're right in the middle there. Mm-hmm. So we're solving their problems and we're solving your problems. We're hoping to match those up into a job, you know, but we're problem solvers. That's what we do. We're problem solvers. We're solving everyone's problem. You know, and we're serving the talent and we're serving the buyers and we're trying to match that up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't work at Disney, so I don't know.
You can't call Mr. Disney and say, hire this person.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Hey, Heather. Can we talk? I want to talk about like how you.
There's like evil looks on his face when he starts to ask
that
question.
It's not even mischief or anything.
It's total mischief.
Okay, when you hear the question, you're going to find
out
that it's not. It's a very sweet question that I have for you.
It's adorable.
Now you're going to feel badly.
But can you tell us your story about how you found your way from Boston to New York and then to LA? That's what
have I told you the story before? How do you know it?
I've never heard this story before.
Because we research.
You researched me.
I'm going to tell you that's correct.
Yeah, Stacey researches a lot. So can you please let us all know about your adventure?
Yeah, my adventure in life. So I grew up in Boston. I went to Tufts University. I thought I wanted to be an actress, and I took some directing classes, and my acting/directing teacher told me what a great director I was. I was obviously insulted, because I was an actor.
Right.
insulted.
Yeah, well, you know, and so I've grown up acting and singing, and I went to New York and promptly was a waiter for 3 years.
A singing waiter?
In the shower.
Okay.
In the shower.
So I decided I didn't want to wait tables anymore, and I wanted to get on the other side. So I wound up becoming a PA for Judge Hatchett.
Did daytime TV.
Mm-hmm, daytime television.
Wow.
I brought crazy people onto daytime television.
Nice.
Then I worked for Montel Williams.
Thank you for that. You were the reality TV precursor. Yeah.
And then I worked for Montel Williams. Then they promoted me and brought me back. And I kept getting promoted and moving back and forth between these shows.
Mm-hmm.
And I think around the age of 26, I realized that I could make a lot of money that way. But I was working 90-hour weeks, and I did not want to have an ulcer by the time I was 30.
Yeah.
And I realized to just, you know, they say get your foot in the door in entertainment, except that like you can be in the basement on the wrong side of town, and like it's not connected to the building you want to be in. So I decided to leave that, and I actually thought I wanted to be in casting, and so I was sending out my stuff to a lot of casting and that sort of stuff, and I applied to a couple agent positions, and two different voiceover agents reached out to me to interview. So I wound up actually taking quite a big pay cut. I became John Wasser's assistant at Atlas.
Mm-hmm.
I fell in love with voiceover very quickly.
This was in New York, right?
Yeah, in New York.
Yeah. Right.
Yep, I was in New York. Because I was from Boston, so my plan was actually never to move to LA originally.
Yeah.
Because I wanted to be able to go back and visit my family. So coming out here when you're making 20 grand a year, it's a big risk.
It's tough,
you know. So that's part of why I was never even on my radar, actually. And so I became John Wasser's assistant within about, and I was, you know, I was a very, you know, I was older than most assistants. They're usually like 22. I was 26, you know. I'd already been, had battle wounds through, you know, the crazy production stuff that I did. So within 9 months, they promoted me. And then about 2 years after that, they asked me to move to LA and open up the Los Angeles office.
Wow.
And so now I've been out here, I think.
And that was like 2007, right?
It was 2009. So I think it was summer of 2009, August 2009. Okay. I think I started going back and forth in 2008, but actually officially moved here August 9th, 2009.
That was pretty fast.
Nice. Yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
From like assistant to like, bam, go run LA.
Yeah.
How
well, so
cool.
Now you get to combine your creativity and your leadership skills.
With my anal retentive business nature.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was going to say business side, but
and
you
I direct
said
people.
Anal retentive.
And it turns out, it turns out I'm good at directing people. And
see,
it's not insulting.
It's all come together.
Yeah. Yeah.
It
wasn't
turns
an
out
insult.
I am actually good at that.
Yeah, it was an actual compliment. Now
so
years
how
later.
Do you how do you stay inspired and motivated? I mean, there's a lot of disruptions in the business right now. There's a lot of shifts. And how do you stay motivated and inspired as an agent?
I don't think it's that hard. It's fun. Mm-hmm. You know, what we're doing is fun. You know, it's voiceover. It's fun. This is what we get to do every day.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, there's a lot of, I mean, a lot of agents' jobs is problem solving. You know, like, I was a producer first, and so I kind of approach agenting like a producer, you know, but it's, you're problem solving. I'm problem solving everyone's problems, and I'm foreseeing what might happen 10 steps down the road and making sure that we, you know, we nip that in the bud before it blows up in everyone's faces, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what our job looks like. And so, first of all, I like that. You know, that's interesting to me. It's what I was looking for in a career, you know? And so, and I'm good at it. And so I enjoy that process.
And no day is the same.
No day is ever the same.
Yeah.
And the owner of the company, one of the owners of the company, Lisa Marvarich, will tell you one of the things she likes best about this line of work is that she's 28, some length of time in, you know, 28 years in, and she still learns every single day.
Yeah.
There's something new to learn every single day that you didn't know before. And every situation is different and everything you approach is different and it's all intuitive and interesting and... So, and then at the same time, you're listening to like, you could be listening to people, you know, transforming from a beetle into a robot in an audition on one day. And then, you know, it's really interesting and different as well. So I don't know, I guess the reason people get jaded is they lose sight of that part of it. And I think you can, if you,
it would be easy.
If you want to be a victim to all the fires you have to put out, I'm sure you can be.
Yes.
But you don't have to be.
Well, you can, enjoy yourself. Can feel the love that you're in love with it. Like you can feel that.
Yeah, but this is just a life lesson, you know, in general, it's how you approach life.
Attitude.
Right.
Like it's not just work. It's, I think, you know, everyone has to approach life the way they approach it. And I think I see the same thing in actors, the people who are a little more jaded and unwilling to remember to get up and enjoy themselves. And you know what? Sometimes that's the problem with people when they're not booking as much.
Yeah.
You know, they're not having fun. There's
the
been
joy.
A couple times I've said to people, you're not having fun anymore. You need to figure out how to have fun and you'll start booking again. You know, because sometimes you're talking to people who are extremely talented. They don't need to fix their reads. You know, it's like, you know, but they need to just have fun and
have
enjoy themselves. And you shouldn't be doing this if it's not fun.
Absolutely.
I mean, everybody says if you're doing it for the money, you're not gonna make any. If you're doing it for the fun, then you're gonna make money.
Yeah. And
so
it goes with that. You have to be, you just have to take it all with a grain of salt and recognize that what we're doing is, you know, putting voice on commercials and animation and it's fun, you know, like it's just a fun job. So I don't know.
Absolutely.
I get it. I get why people are jaded. I just think there's no reason to be.
So do you have any, Heather wisdom for people watching that are wanting to pursue voiceover, have success in today's market?
Well, first I would say you need to work your butt off, whatever that looks like for you. Be a business person. And then the most important thing is to be a kind human being.
Yay.
Be nice to people.
Yes.
Be kind to people.
Yes.
You know, the adage about how you treat someone's assistant, you know, they're going to be your agent next potentially.
Yes, they
are.
The
last couple of assistants I've had are now working at animation houses, you know, and hiring talent. So, you know, you want to be just a nice person. People want to work with people that are kind and they like. And
they want to have around.
Yeah. And of course, you know, talent matters as well, but when you work hard and you're also a nice person, the amount of times that I've had buyers tell me like, oh my gosh, you guys are a great agency, you're great, but your talent is so nice. Like, I just, it's so awesome. They're just so nice and they're so great to work with that I just like, that's what clinches it for me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, okay,
that's
you know,
cool.
It matters.
Yeah, yeah, it does matter.
Well, that's
it's
great
so
advice
important.
For life.
Absolutely.
Not just
absolutely.
VoiceOver. I love it. Heather, this is a mystery question, my friend.
Uh-oh. Oh, gosh. Okay.
So you can pick from wherever you would like.
Oh, gosh.
If you'd like to read it or I can read it, whatever works for you.
This feels
as Chuck always says,
scary.
Read it in your favorite character voice. Yeah,
oh, no, I can't. No, I know. No.
She's like, no.
Read it in your
oh, God.
In your newlywed voice.
Oh, God, that's the same voice. There's
oh,
no
that's
difference.
The same voice.
There's no difference. It's just me. Okay, this is great because I just answered this
aha.
question.
Okay.
If you could give all human beings one virtue, which would you choose? Compassion.
Compassion.
Bam.
Yes.
Easy, just
yes.
like that.
That was simple. I got that
compassion.
one.
Compassion.com, people.
Compassion.com.
Yes.
Well, listen.
That's beautiful.
We're going to close by just saying this. First of all, thank you so much. We
yes,
know that you're extremely
treat to
busy.
Have you here.
So having you come here, taking a little bit of time off of work and your family to share with us and share with them is greatly appreciated.
Yes.
I knew we'd get you here one of these years.
Well, you haven't stopped.
And I'm just glad that this was the year. And you're like, okay.
She's like, yeah. You haven't stopped.
So it's almost like getting an agent. I,
yeah.
call,
well,
I caught you
the time
you at the
was
right
coming.
Time.
I was just waiting for yeah. you to call
we
me again.
We were just
again.
Waiting
oh,
for you
good.
For the name change.
Oh, it was perfect
you know,
timing. Yes,
perfect.
Perfect timing.
Now, you know, you will forever be in the archive.
Absolutely.
Yes. Heather Dane.
Heather
yes.
Dane.
So,
I'm starting to like it more as it's being said.
I
it's
love
a great
it. Heather
name.
Dane. Heather Dane. Heather
Dane.
So thank you. And thank you for yeah. to John and Lisa and all your
yes,
other agents for letting you share with us as well.
Yeah.
We certainly appreciate that. We will see you guys next time.
Hi, I'm Heather Dane from Atlas Talent, and I just got buzzed with Chuck and Stacey. And I hope some of what I said today was helpful for you guys.
Well, that concludes our two-part episode with the awesome Heather Dane of
yes.
Atlas Talent. Wow.
Amazing. Yeah. The whole team, John and Lisa and everyone out here, really, really great. Hope you guys got a lot out of it. Leave your comments below and don't forget to keep up with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We love you. Thanks for watching as always. And just remember,
you always have
time for a little buzz.
Buzz Weekly is sponsored by Chuck Duran's Demos That Rock. The voiceover demo producer to the stars is now available to you. Visit demosthatrock.com and take your voiceover career to the next level.
See you next time. And remember, you always have time for a little buzz.